Hey, everybody. This is Ricky Rackman from Headbangers Ball and the Cat Outs Hollywood podcast. And you are listening to Talk To Me. And of course, remember to keep one foot in the gutter, one fist in the gold.
What is up, everybody? Welcome into Talk To Me. This is episode 212. And yes, this week is actually episode 212. If you listened last week, I said 212, but it was actually 211. I had a few people catch that and email into the show. It was a lot of fun to see who actually caught that and wanted to point it out. But yeah, this week is episode 212. The guest this week is the mighty Gene Hoagland, the Atomic Clock himself, checking in once again. I believe this is his fourth time on the show. He is the drummer of Testament, Dark Angel, played in Strapping Young Lad and Death and Fear Factory and so much more. Always a great chat. I think four is the most people have been on the show. I think I'm going to have to do like Saturday Night Live and have a five timers club. So I think Max Cavalera, you're on the list to next time you're on the podcast. Five times, and the next time Gene Hoagland's on, that'll also be five times. So Gene Hoagland is on this week to talk about the new Testament album, what he is up to writing with Dark Angel. We get into a lot of business stuff, go real in-depth with stuff. I just listened to this interview, and probably one of my favorites I've done. We go all over the map talking about so many topics. Nice about 45-minute, 50-minute chat with Gene Hoagland. And you guys know that the Talk To Me podcast is brought to you by Scott Bowling. Yes, our good friend down in Atlanta, Georgia, who you just heard on a Best of Talk To Me Live. I put out two bots episodes. I'm going to call them bots. The Chris Aiken interview from the live Talk To Me from last Thursday and the live interview with Scott Bowling. Both were posted throughout the week. And I'll throw those in occasionally throughout the week. Kind of some extra content, some bonus content, some best of Talk To Me from uncontrolledNoise.com. The live show, as always, will be Thursday nights, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. 2 hours of conversation and music. It's a lot of fun. I'm having a great time over there at Uncontrolled Noise. But back to Scott Bowling and his show, Good Company. Make sure you are going over to YouTube or going to ScottGoodCompany.com. Checking out Good Company with Bowling. So many great interviews over there. So many well-shot interviews over there. Great questions, answers, all that stuff. Interviews with Head from Korn, Stuck Mojo, Seven Dust, Ricky Rackman, Matt Pinfield, Eddie Trunk, Jose Mangan. It's a who's who over there at the Good Company with Bowling. So make sure you let them know that the Talk To Me podcast sent you, and that will be much appreciated. Not much more this week, so make sure if you want to support the podcast monetarily, you're going over to patreon.com/talktome, choosing a tier. That will be much appreciated. Always leave a nice five-star rating, nice five-star review on iTunes, Apple Podcasts, whatever they're turning that into, Facebook recommendations, all that stuff counts, and it's great to see. Leave a rating and review wherever you can. And without any more of my ramblings, let's check out some Testament. Talk to Gene Hoagland, check out some Dark Angel, and then I will talk to you momentarily.
Yo, this is Trevor from Obituary, and you're listening to Talk To Me.
Yeah, fan favorite of the show, Gene Hoagland.
Oh, hey, howdy, everybody. How you guys doing?
Well, let's jump right into it. You're talking about doing some Dark Angel stuff, and I'm not going to call it Death Angel this time. It's always Dark Angel.
Hey, that's fun.
So what's the latest on the Dark Angel stuff?
Well, Jim and I have really forged ahead writing over this this last little period of time, and We were able to obtain a little e-drum kit thing, so that's helpful for our little demos that we're in the process of making, and we're just throwing around a ton of ideas at each other, and it's really awesome. God, you know, working with Jim has always been really cool, and we've always had, you know, the kind of writing relationship where we work best in a room together, couple of guitars, you know, I'll throw out an idea that Jim will embellish that, or he'll throw out an idea and I'll throw a tag on his stuff. We work really well together, and now we got a little drum kit set up, so it's like, okay, great ideas, let me throw down a quick little beat, and that's how it's commencing forward as of this moment. So that's pretty good.
That sounds good. So you're working with an e-drum kit, so you pretty much are you running it through a PA, or is this strictly headphones? He's like doing a Fractal or a Kemper.
What we are doing is essentially we run it through Jim's PA speakers from his, you know, in his studio speakers. That's essentially how we do it. Like we'll jam it out together, or I'll lay down the drums and he'll drop the guitars on, or I'll drop the guitars on. Mm-hmm. You know, once we get a little drum idea going, either of us will fire up the guitar on it. Sometimes he tracks with me, and sometimes he'll come back a little later and drop the tracks on then. So it's all super cool.
So how much actual guitar writing do you do, and have you done over the years?
Well, I guess if we're talking about Dark Angel, I started writing on the Darkness Descends record.
Oh, wow.
And that was, you know, I started throwing out some ideas there, and that was pretty cool. Like, I had a lot of hand in, there was a couple riffs in Hunger of the Undead and Black Prophecies. That was, you know, Jim and myself. And what else? Death of Certain Life Is Not, you know, wrote a bunch of stuff on that one and a couple of the other tunes here and there. And then by Leave Scars, I was writing a lot more, and I was actually starting to play guitar on the albums by Leave Scars. That was me tracking a lot of the guitars on that one, and Time Does Not Heal, I was doing the same thing. Like, all the real technical songs that I'd write, the band was like, bug that, you track them, and then we'll deal with playing them live later, you know, with everyone. One of those technical songs that you wrote, if we end up playing those live, then we'll figure it out as we go. And that's kind of how that worked. So
has that carried through, you know, through Death and Strapping Young Lad and Testament? Did that your songwriting carry through, or is that mainly just Dark Angel?
To a degree, yes. You know, every once in a while, I had riffs with Strapping and I remember kind of guiding Chuck through some stuff. Like for instance, I've mentioned this before a couple of times. When Chuck and I first got together for the Individual Thought Patterns record, I was working off I call it the adorable demo tape, just the adorable riff tape that he sent. And I was noticing on that riff tape that a lot of the songs were being played really high up on the neck, or down on the neck. God, I never know how guitarists call it, but a lot of the riffs that were in E were in high E. Okay. And working off the A string and the, you know, E at the seventh position on the A string. A lot of them were based around that. And I remember the first day Chuck and I got together for the Individual Thought Patterns record, I grabbed a guitar and I was like, hey, tell you what, teach me all your riffs. That's going to help me figure out, you know, little drum patterns and things like that, like accents and nuances and stuff. And hey, how would you feel about, you know, like some of these riffs are way up here. How about we try taking them down here and getting them down low and getting super crunchy? And he was like, oh man, I didn't even think of that, man. Great idea. Yeah. Okay. So now those riffs are down there. So now they're heavy. So that's pretty cool. So, you know, and with Testament, on the latest record, it was very, very minor, but, you know, I augmented a few of Eric's riffs and threw out a couple to when we were both kind of like, okay, we've got a bunch of songs down and now we're not out of ideas, but right now, why don't we just try a fresh approach to something? I'd pick up the guitar and show Eric something. He'd be like, okay, let me go off that. And, you know, little arrangement ideas. And I tell you, that's where I work pretty darn well is, hey, let me arrange the stuff. You know, like I'm a really good arranger. And so when it comes to say, like my wife, Lara, and I, we have our project together that we've been working on for a while, and she writes all the riffs and I arrange the riffs and, you know, just let me have that. And I can do a pretty good job there. So there you go.
Well, that actually kind of dovetails right into something I wanted to talk to you about, and that's, you know, being a drummer, a lot of times the drummers don't get the same songwriting credits as, you know, say the guitar player, the bass player. You know, you almost don't even get the same, you know, royalties when it comes to, you know, actually just playing, because a lot of times, you know,
absolutely,
I think a lot of times they view what you do as more of an accompaniment than actually a part of the song. So And the, how that kind of correlates into your being kind of a hired gun for a lot of acts too. So a lot of times, you know, when you finish the Testament album, you're not getting that Testament royalty check from, you know, Practice What You Preach or whatever. So, I mean, you know, you have to fill that in with other stuff. So just kind of, I guess, kind of talk the listener through that, you know, like why the drummers don't get the same, you know, songwriting credits as most, even though a lot of times, you know, you are doing what you're saying, you are arranging, you are, you know, kind of pointing out little nuances here and there.
Well, that is a real good question that is absolutely a mystery to many drummers, including myself, is, you know, it seems like it was mandated by the music business 60-70 years ago that drums are, that's not writing, you know. And I know that I understand if it is like just a standard little rock beat that has been played thousands of millions of times, I get it. If it's the standard, you know, little, you know, 2-4 kind of rock thing, I get that. You know, whoever wrote that or whoever put that into a song, I understand. You didn't, you are envisioning somebody else's idea and you're putting it into your current rock song. However, you tell me one kick-ass rock song that doesn't have drums as the bass, you know, right. Like, and especially metal. And especially, like, say, you like just taking my examples as an example, say you take a couple of albums like say Individual Thought Patterns and Symbolic. What I tried to do is I tried to create patterns that had never been written before, and so there, the drummer has written a drum part. And many times, like, say, for instance, when it comes to a band like Fear Factory, Dino does not write one riff that is not based on drums.
Right.
Like, Dino never once came to the table like, I got these riffs, what kind of drums can you put to these? No, it's the exact opposite. I can't write a riff until I hear what you're doing on the drums, and Gene, you come up with some patterns, do that patterny double kick stuff that you are known for, and say, for instance, Fear Factory is known for. And then I can build a song from that. I can't build a song until I have the bass to build it on. And so that's where I'm like, okay, drums, you know, drums are absolutely writing. I don't make the rules, but I sure would if I could change them. I would be the first one signing on that. You know, that petition, because absolutely, like, drums, it doesn't matter how good your guitarist is, and I think this is pretty much a well-known just concept in music, is that your guitarist can be effing amazing, your guitarist can be incredible, your singer can be incredible, but if your drummer blows, your band blows. That's, you know, like, you name one band that's out there that is killing it, where their drummer just is effing terrible. That just doesn't happen. You got to kick out the drummer and get a new guy that can do the stuff. So drums are absolutely, I know it's metal, I get it, but this isn't my concept. This was actually explained to me by guitarists over the years, is that drums are the most important part of every rock metal song ever written. I'm like, hey, thanks for the credit. Pay up, sucker.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many instances of, you know, you hear guys talking about their writing process and how, you know, they sit down with a guitar and they'll pull up drum loops of John Bonham and whoever else and just start noodling along, and then all of a sudden they've got a riff, but it's based on, you know, some drums that they've heard somewhere else. And it's always been some sort of a weird anomaly in music that, you know, drummers don't get their due when it comes to songwriting and, you know, publishing and royalties and all that stuff. So I'm standing on the rock for you, Gene.
Oh, I appreciate that, Josh. That's excellent. You know, because I tell you, there's been many times when I've been working with guitarists and they're like, man, I got to tell you, it's not going to be permanent, but right now I am tapped on ideas. I can't come up with anything. I'll be like, no problem, here, let me lay down some stuff for you. Let me, you know, juice your brain a little bit with some cool beats. Every time, 100% of the time, they're like, oh, dude, you know, writing, you know, all of a sudden the writing just kicks in, and they're like, dude, I had nothing. And they're just hearing, you know, and I've done the Superior 2.0, I've done the Easy Drummer stuff, and I'm just not catching a vibe off certain things. I can't find what I am looking for to juice my creative processes. But here, right there in the last, you know, you playing drums for 5 minutes and laying a quick little something down, look at what it led to. You know, we got an entire song now because you laid down some cool beat for me. That happens all the time, you know? So drummers are important, and F you if you don't agree with that. And, you know, that's the way I see it. So.
Preach,
and that,
brother.
And that, yeah, and that does come from being a drummer and a guitarist, you know? Like, I'm in the same boat. You know, like, right. I could be sitting there like, I just don't have any ideas. And, you know, finally, I'll just, you know, I wish I did use, like, say, I don't use the Superior drummer. You know, I don't even have that. You know, like, I don't have it on my computer. I mean, dude,
well, it's because you are a Superior drummer.
Oh, that is very nice. Thank you very much. But I tell you, you know, having like a little drum loop, I'll go to YouTube every now and then. They just throw up drum loops all over the place on YouTube, and I'll just, you know, go pick a thrash metal beat at whatever BPM I feel like right now. It's like, boom. Okay, great. A lot of ideas. Just having that little beat just going boop at boop at boop at boop at boop at in the background, that right. just, you know, turns your brain on for ideas and concepts and things like that. So that's pretty good.
So without getting into numbers and logistics and who does what and who pays what and stuff, the one thing about your career is, you know, you have been kind of a hired gun since Dark Angel, you know, going into Death and Testament and Strapping Lad and, you know, filling in with Unearth and Fear Factory and whatever else, like all these bands. But, you know, normally those are specific jobs. You know, you are here for this one album and this one tour cycle, and that's what we need you for, Gene. Here is your cash. You know, you don't really, I don't know how it works. You know, I don't know what you're getting from certain things and, you know, what's in perpetuity and all this other nonsense. But for the most part, I'm assuming your life is kind of revolved around here's your next paying gig. And it's, you know, once the money's done with that, then you move on to the next and blah, blah, blah. So Testament has recorded an album and you've kind of got some downtime. So the whole, I don't know how much mailbox money is showing up, you know, quote unquote. So, I mean, what do you do at this kind of a lull right now? I know obviously you're doing some Dark Angel stuff. Are you looking for, you know, some other, you know, somebody that needs a studio drummer, somebody that needs to fill in for this show? I mean, do you try to keep yourself as busy as possible, trying to, you know, make the ends meet, the quote unquote ends meet?
To a degree, yes. Fortunately, how do I put it? I get paid well enough that sometimes I only need to do a couple of things here and I'm good for a couple of months. If I need some downtime to concentrate on other things, like I tell you, over the last year or so, I have had to concentrate on so many non-music business related items of business in my life that I've been fortunate to have, like, you know, I took time off while writing the Testament record. I devoted my time only to Testament and Dark Angel writing. And since I was home a lot, my wife and I have seriously moved forward on our project. But I wasn't out there taking like, oh, well, I got to, hey, Testament, sorry, I can't be there for the writing because I'm going to be on the road for 2 months with, you know, band.
Right.
Took that time off and that was helpful for Testament. It was helpful for me, so I just didn't show up at the session with, you know, where they hand a demo over to me and say, hey, just play what's on the demo. That's not fun. That's not right. Creative. That's not, you know, that brings out a growly Gene. We don't like growly Gene. I like being happy dude Gene. So being a part of the writing process just meant, hey, Testament, your albums are going to be done. I mean, your drums are going to be done fucking awesomely on your record. And Eric has a lot to say about the drums. It is not 100% out of my brain what goes on a Testament record, but I'm okay with that because I get 80% of, hey, this is the way I feel like playing it. And sometimes Eric will be like, hey, can you, that fill that you're doing there, I'm not feeling. Can you do like a fill that's going to drive it through to the next part? Of course. No problem. It's your session. It's your band. I'm here to help you envision, you know, get your vision across. I am a good drum writer. I'm a good drum envisioner myself. So if you allow me the freedom to, I'll envision your song and then if you have augmentations that you need to hear or you're looking for, absolutely, let's get to those as well. So everybody's happy. Eric's happy. He's got the drums he's looking for. Even Chuck came in one time while I was tracking, and I had all these ideas for this song. It was one of Alex's songs, and Chuck was like, hey, Gene, can you make, you know, and I was tracking the song. I had already tracked most of the song, and Chuck had heard it from the beginning, and he was like, hey, man, can you maybe change the beginning drum beat, you know, so it's just a little different than when the vocals come in? I'm like, okay, let's look at that. And then we ended up changing the drums for the entire song from that, but from that little inception of an idea. But back to your original question, just Yeah, I'm fortunate. I do get paid well, and you know, to hire Gene, not that cheap on you, and you know that but you get the total package. You know, I come with an imaginative drum brain, and I try to be cool and pretty up for the entire session. I'm usually a pretty up guy, unless I get super frustrated with the business aspect of what's happening right here. And I don't get into that situation too much. I got management to take care of most of my biz for that sort of thing. And so I could just be happy dude Gene playing drums for you and making a kick-ass record, you know, so that's always good. But there are, you know, like, yeah, you're right. I'm a hired gun, you know, and I do look for things like I said, I purposely shut everything down. I didn't make any announcement at the end of last year saying, hey, everybody, Gene's going to be available for a lot of time because all I'm doing is write the Testament, a Dark Angel, and a Gene and His Wife project. I'm going to have plenty of time available. So if anybody needs to get a hold of me for a tour or an album or something, you know, reach out. I didn't say that, but I'm sure in the future, I will probably be doing something like that when I have downtime and, you know, just like, hey, everybody, I'm here. Somebody want to give me a shout? Let's work together. Let's do it. I can see something like that happening in the future where, you know, it keeps me rolling, keeps my brain super engaged in the music, you know, like I love working with new people, you know, I like working with everybody I have in the past, but there's always, you know, there's always, if there is an opportunity, I tend to examine them, absolutely. You know, I've had to turn down a bunch of things over the years where it's like, ah, man, I wish I had the time available for that. But I know you're reaching out 6 months in advance, but I know what I'm doing in 6 months from now, and I can't fit that into a schedule or anything. And I'm sure the pay is going to be fine, but I just can't fit that into the schedule. So hopefully somewhere in the future it's going to be, yeah, Gene's pretty available, and hey, everybody, give me a shout. You know,
a second ago you said you kind of immersed yourself a little bit into some business outside of music. If I remember correctly, and I've seen it online, you know, you've kind of delved into the CBD hemp area. Is that something you're into these days?
That is from, I guess, let me see. I ingest it. I don't run any business involved with that.
Okay.
My non-music business related stuff has been very personal, family oriented stuff.
Oh,
and
okay.
So that's taken quite a lot of energy to get through and deal with and all this stuff. It's business, but but yeah, when it comes to like, say, you know, I work with High on Life Superfoods.
There it is.
And I enjoy their stuff. I like doing their stuff. And when they said, hey, man, can we use your name on some of this? I'm like, of course. You know, absolutely. I'm down with your product. I like it. And, you know, they're reaching out and getting a bigger, you know, just a larger platform for themselves or whatever it is, a little spotlight on their company. If I can help that in any way, totally. You know, if I believe in something, I'll go for it,
right.
You know, like for instance, the attack rack on my drum. Yes, that is made by Eric Meyer of Dark Angel, and he's my friend and he's my bandmate, and he created the company, but he created it. I don't work for Attack Rack at all. Or, you know, they've given me a couple of attack racks, but I'll still go out and tell everybody, dude, Attack Rack is effing killer because I believe in the product. If I believe in you, you don't have to pay me, you know, or I don't want to say that out loud, but
yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, I believe in the attack rack. I believe in lit. If I'm going to attach my name to something, you got to be truthful about it. You just can't be like, oh, I use Axe body spray because it pays me a lot of money, you know?
Well, that would probably be the only reason to use Axe body spray and tell everybody you do it.
Yeah.
Is if they paid you a lot of money.
You couldn't pay me enough to wear that stuff.
The funny thing is, you know, you talk about, well, I guess we were talking about the business side of music, and the one thing that came out recently about Jay-Z being hip-hop's first billionaire, and it was billed as hip-hop's first billionaire, But if you, and I forget which media outlet broke it down, but only 75 million of that, which is a lot of money, don't get me wrong, 75 million of that was music, and everything else was some sort of business venture that he's a part of. So even though he's,
I can see that.
He was technically the first billionaire of hip hop. Only a very small portion of that billion was from music, which I thought was a very telling sign.
Absolutely, and that's, you know, everybody is trying to diversify, and I understand that. You know, I mean, I will have some ancillary business somewhere in the future that probably does not involve music, but you know, hey, this is a really good payer, and that's one thing. You get a little bit older, you start understanding how to, you know, making money is easy, you know, having some sort of business that makes money. I find that to be pretty relatively simple for me, you know. But it's, when I was young, I just thought, well, this is what I want to do. I want to play music, and I set my goals very low. It was like, I just want to make enough money to pay the bills and get my rent paid, get the groceries, get a little car payment going. And then it blew up way beyond that. You know, now I set my goals higher, and you can't lose doing that. And I guess, yeah, I don't have goals. I have expectations, and all my expectations always come true. I always get what I want. You know, it's like, and now I do shoot for the stars. I used to just shoot for the little, you know, space up ahead of us. But, you know, now I shoot a lot higher in my expectations. And I think that's one way, like, not to use the term manifest, but I'm able to manifest a bitchin', kick-ass life for myself. I've got the most wonderful life. I love my life. That's why Gene's a pretty happy dude, you know. Like, I enjoy my life. I get to play drums for a living and make the odd business decision that helps, and you know, that's pretty cool. You know, I'm stoked that I get to use a passion as my
source of income.
I guess,
yeah.
You know, yeah, totally. So I'm very fortunate, and I love my life. I'm very happy with what I'm doing, and now I've learned, hey, set your expectations higher, and that can only help. And sure enough, it does. You know, we drive a hard bargain for you to have Gene Hoagland playing for you. I tell you.
So, do you find it funny in 2019 touring, 2018, 2020, this whole era of touring, when you're going out with bands and they're having a juice bar and they're going to the gym and they're on their laptops running their side business? You know, to where like 30 years ago, it was about, you know, how many Jaeger bombs we can drink and how fast we can pass out and how many chicks we
sure.
can be. You know, it's a completely different world out there, isn't it?
Absolutely. You know, I like to joke that we used to be rock and rolla, now we're raw granola. And,
nice.
You know, it's like, and I just think that's people becoming a little more aware of becoming a little sharper and smarter about, you know, if I think guys that are getting up there, once you start getting into your 40s or something, I would imagine you start think, I guess I did. It's like, hey, what's my longevity at this? You know, I remember telling my wife Laura tells me, she's like, when you and I met, you were like, I probably got about another 10 years in this business, and I figure I'll probably croak around, like, you know, maybe in the late 50s, early 60s. And she was just like mind boggled at the, you know, just a capitulation in that statement, you know, and she's like, fuck you, asshole. You know, you're going to be around for a long time, you know, like, we're going to help you do this. And now my attitude is, you know, Gene, you love your life. Extend it. You know, you love doing what you're doing. You want to be, you know, I've mentioned this many times in interviews, like my expectation is to be doing what I do right now in my 70s, you know, I'm 50 something now, 51. Yeah. 51. You know, I mean, like I'm healthier than I've been. I'm healthier and I look better than I did in my 30s, you know, just 12 years ago, that's not that long ago, and I feel better, I play better, I'm way more on it than I was just a few years ago, and that's just because of my concentration on trying to be a healthy body. And I've mentioned that in granted, I still want to lose another 30 or 40 pounds and also get cut and ripped by the time I'm in my 70s. So I'm 51 now. I feel like I'm 27. Like I said, I've mentioned this before. When I'm in my 70s, I can get away with the carriage that I have right now, the body size and style that I have right now. I can get away with it at 50. I'm a lot less than I was at, I weigh a lot less than I did at 40. And however, in my 70s, I might not be able to get away with this carriage with in my 70s, trying to do the hauling, killing double bass. So I figure that's why I'll be the cut, ripped, jacked up 70-year-old. And right now I feel like I'm 27. If I lose another 40 pounds but put on a shit ton of muscle and I got abs of steel and buns of steel and all that whatnot when I'm 70, maybe I'll feel like I'm 22, because I do not feel 51. God, remember when 51 was like your grandparents' age? And like,
right.
You are ancient, granddad. You're 52 and I can't even conceive of your age. You are ancient. Now, I've been hearing them say 50 is the new 30, which makes, 9 p.m. the new midnight. But that's pretty fun.
Yeah, it's funny, man. I turned 40 in 2 weeks from today, and I was looking back to when I turned 30. You think life is over, and you're like, oh my God, you're in your 30s, and I'm like, I'm looking forward to 40. Like I'm ready for it. I've got some gray coming in the goatee, and I feel older and wiser, and maybe a little bit smarter than I did when I was going into my 30s. So I'm looking forward to 40. I can't wait.
That's awesome because. I don't mean to sound corny or cloying, but it does just get better. Your brain gets smarter. You start figuring stuff out. Like, let me ask you, when you were in your 30s, like mid 30s, 35, 34, 37, 38, did you figure out a lot of things about life? Like, say, finances, for instance. Like, was there any, like, you know what? I'm actually pretty good at finance. I'm good at figuring stuff out. I'm good at making more money. Did that happen for you in the mid-30s?
Honestly, it probably just happened in the last year where money actually started to make sense.
Yes. Okay, well, there you go. In your 30s, either way.
Yeah.
Like, for me, it happened the same way. Like, in my 30s is when I figured out, hey, I know what to do to make a lot of money. Like, I've been handcuffed by Junior in a band, and if that band does not... It was in my 30s when I started, coming up. I don't know if it's branding. I don't know what it's called, but putting yourself, Gene, out there as a brand. It was in my 30s when I figured that out, and my 40s, I loved it. Now I'm in my 50s, and I'm looking forward to my 70s. Like, holy fuck, dude, things are that good that you're looking that far ahead that you're like, fuck, it's going to be awesome then. it's awesome now, I'm stoked.
And by that time, medical advances will have us living to like we're 150, so.
It doesn't, nutritional advances, like, I don't do anything medical. I used to be on all the pills, like for my diabetes that I used to have that I no longer have. Mm-hmm. I used to be on all the metformins metabolism boosting.
Right.
I was born hypothyroidic, meaning my mom had her thyroid removed before I was born, and I was born hypothyroidic, meaning I have a very slow metabolism. I no longer have a slow metabolism. My metabolism is normal, if not, pretty darn juiced, actually, because and that's all through nutrition.
Right.
I am no fan of big pharma. That is the racket of all rackets. I'm no fan of that, and I will absolutely, there have been many people that have come to me and said, hey, man, well, I hear what you're talking about, Gene, I get it, but I'm on this kind of medication because I've got this going on, and I might know something about that medication and what they're going, what's going on with them, and I'll be like, don't do that, do this, you know, like, drop those meds. I know it's scary. I know those, but you drop those meds in conjunction with like fucking juicing your liver or, you know, whatever it takes, you're going to be fine. And, you know, that's my preaching to people. But,
oh yeah. I mean, the science is out there that shows that, you know, a lot of people that get off of these, all the, like, you know, 37 pills they take every morning and just go vegan. And the next thing you know, they've lost all signs of any ailment they ever had. So there's definitely a lot in nature that can cure us all.
Absolutely. And I admit, if it weren't for my wife, Laura, I would not know any of this. She's completely taught me, and I just try to pass that knowledge on to others. And I got to admit, it's helpful. My drum tech, Jeff, he's a vegan. He's been a vegan forever. And so, you know, it's like when we're out together, it's like it's cool having somebody else. You know, I'm not vegan by any means, but having somebody else who is very health oriented, health conscious, already knows all the stuff that I've been learning from Laura. He's already known a lot of this stuff. That's cool to be surrounded by, you know, that kind of support and that kind of knowledge and things like that. So, you know, that makes touring a little bit easier, you know.
With the latest Testament album, how far along are we, and when should we look forward to that?
I think the album is done. I think.
I've being the hired hand drummer, right?
Oh yeah. I've always said I'm the mushroom drummer. I'm the kept in the dark, fed bullshit. It's all good with everything. That's fine. But I've been. You know, we do have the Dropbox files that are shared. And since I finished my drum last month, I check in with that Dropbox every once in a while, see how it's coming. And the vocals are coming. The lyrics are all, you know, all Chuck's parts are coming. And I hear Alex's leads are going down and Eric's leads are happening and more rhythm guitars are happening. And I know the band was shooting for completing the album by June 12th. Tomorrow's June 12th, right?
2 days. Yeah, that's Wednesday. No, that, yeah, that, you, oh. you are right. You are right. That is tomorrow. I was thinking today was Monday.
Yeah, fair enough. I know that they had that as a pretty hard target for completion of all the tracks. And then I don't know what Andy Sneap is up to. I think Andy's probably out on the road with Judas Priest or something, but I understand Andy will be mixing it. We tracked with Juan Urdiaga, like we have the past, you know, couple of things. And Juan's great to work with. You know, people might know him from the Machine Head albums that he's done. And he's done a lot of tracking for Testament in the past, as well as, you know, Ted Nugent, Night Ranger. God, you name it. He's done a whole shit. But Juan's awesome to work with. I love tracking Juan. He's, you know, he's a cool guy, super positive, and that's always fun. So I know that they got to get the stuff, because we leave for Europe day after tomorrow. And we're going to be gone for 3 weeks, and there ain't going to be anything done. So I am not the person to be making the official statement, but I believe the band wants to get the album out in 2019, I think. And in order to do so, it had to be completed by middle of June so it could get mixed whenever it's mixed, and then, you know, pressed and whatnot. So I would imagine Testament is shooting for a 2019 release, and I would also imagine if that didn't happen, then early 2020. So,
well, if it's as good as the last two albums, I put on Brotherhood of the Snake on the way into work today, and I actually showed up early because it made me drive so fast. And such a great album, man! It's so the last two Testament albums have been, you know, some of the best of their career, and I know that has a lot to do with you. So hopefully this new album will stand the test of time.
I think it will. You know, it's another killer Testament record. You know, it's going to fit real nicely with the last 2-3 records. You know, like since they returned and with Formation of Damnation, you know, Dark Roots, Brotherhood, the new one. I don't even know what the title is yet. But it's gonna be a like I've said before, it's gonna be a kick ass killer Testament record. Testament fans are really gonna enjoy this. So, you know, it's not like it's like, oh fuck, what happened? No, it's gonna be like killer, way to go, dude. Nice work. This is kick ass. So,
well, I can't wait. What's the future of what's the future of Dark Angel at the moment? I know you're doing some recording or some demoing.
Yeah, well, yeah, we're demoing and writing, and we hope to be in the studio before the end of the year. We're hoping for that. We're hoping for a you know, early-ish 2020 release, and then that will end up being you know, the figurehead for some actual touring, because we will remain doing our spot dates that we do. Like, for instance, we have a show coming up in Mexico, and then we have some other stuff hopefully on the books coming up soon, and that's going to be cool. So we got that rolling, and my wife Lara's learned, you know, we got shit ton of stuff going on there with that project. And I know I've told people about that project forever, and I understand you're impatient for that, but I'm stoked for that because it's really moving forward. She's doing vocals now as well, and which is, hey, all I can speak of is her bandmate on this. I think she's doing a fucking incredible job. You know, I'm stoked as her drummer going, fuck, those are your vocals? Killer. I'm stoked. I'm so excited for that. And this, I give her a lot of props because, you know, obviously nobody knows our music yet, but our riffs that she is singing over, they ain't easy to play on guitar, let alone rubbing your head and patting your belly as trying to do vocals on top of that shit. So,
was there,
way to go,
there a
Lara,
name
man,
of that project?
We still don't have the name. We haven't even been worried about it. We just know that. But we also haven't really, like, we have not sat down and brainstormed, hey, let's you and I put our brains together and come up with a name tonight. We've never done that. Because I know that if we were to do that, we would have the name. I put names up on our little list. She puts names on our list. And, you know.
That's got to be the hardest thing.
That's just it. I love every single name I threw out there. She loves every single name she threw up there. And I don't think either of us are quite feeling each other's names yet. So it's like, F it. Let's take a night. Fuck, just get it going and throw out every single name we think of, and we'll come up with something. That's why I haven't been too concerned about, you know, we only need the name before we release it, and we're nowhere near releasing it. So that's not been the high priority, but I know the name that we get is going to be kick-ass. So I'm stoked.
All right, and the Atomic Clock 3 DVD, anything like that coming out? Or are you going to launch a YouTube channel and a Patreon and all that stuff? Or what are you doing there?
That is some of the things that will probably end up displaying itself as the wisest choice. You know, I don't know if I would do another DVD. I've done a couple of them, and those are awesome. Sold really well. I'm stoked with them, but Those are massive projects, and I intend to be so busy with all the fucking awesome music being made that I don't know if I'm going to get the chance to tackle a momentous project like that. For instance, if I didn't have Dark Angel or the project with Lara and I, if I had a bunch of nothing going on, maybe I'd consider doing another DVD, but Dark Angel's a massive project. My stuff with Lara, another massive project. Testament, that just kind of runs itself. I show up, play some drums. That's awesome. And so any of the future things, like I say, if I do make an announcement, like, hey, everybody, I got some time available here. Let's get together and do something. I'm open for that as well, but I just figured I'm going to end up being so busy with all that. Perhaps the momentous project of another DVD, maybe you just do a YouTube channel or something, Gene. Just do some filming and get some mics up, do some stuff. You know, maybe release something once a week or something. The sky is the limit, so I'm excited about that. So that's pretty fun.
Yeah, I was watching YouTube before we got on this call, and I was watching reaction videos to your video of your Atomic Clock DVD of people just playing a snippet of your DVD and then talking about it. So, I mean, you know, YouTube is endless in what you can do out there with so many things that people do, you know, reaction videos to reaction videos and all that nonsense.
That's fun. Reacting to that's awesome. Hey, tell you what, stop reacting to it. Make your own. You're probably a good drummer.
Some guy was talking about your twitch and your torso and all this nonsense, and I was like, all right, this is getting way too deep. I gotta call Gene, so I gotta get off this one.
Oh, holy moly, I did not know I had a twitch in my torso. That's pretty good. Thank you for whoever pointed that out.
Well, last question. I don't know how big of a sports fan you are, but I know you're a big Metallica fan like I am. How cool is it for you to see Metallica doing stuff like the Star Spangled Banner before an NBA game? You know, what made me ask you that is the fact that after they did it, you know, I listen to a lot of sports talk during the day while I'm working, and every sports talk radio station was talking about it. So it's way bigger than metal, you know, when they get into that arena.
Nice. Well, you know, anything that draws a spotlight to our style of music is only helpful. I understand if you are super young and you are an underground weenie, just like I was, that would be horrifying to me to see some metal band doing something big and bringing a spotlight to metal. I'd be like, fuck that, you know. Fuck you, Iron Maiden, for putting out Number of the Beast. Now you're popular. Now you're not my band anymore, you know, like. That sort of thing. So, but hey, great for Metallica, you know, and I know they've been doing that in front of giant games for past few years. Right. That's super fun and all of that. And hey, I know, you know, Joey Belladonna goes out and he does some, when he's on tour, he'll get brought down to the local, you know, whether he's doing it for the Cubs or the Vikings. I know that's his team there. You know, me, I'm a massive Dallas Cowboys fan, but I got to tell you, I have been sports guy, sports, music, both, for my entire life until over the last couple of years when my focus on news has been news, you know, like I remember seeing Jim Jeffries a few months back. He was saying, you know, I never used to know who the attorney general was or, you know, I would know the president, the vice president, secretary of state, and that's it. I do not know who, you know, the Department of Defense president, you know, head leader is. And now I know all of this because I have to. And I'm like, I'm kind of in that boat now. I was a political idiot up until 2-3 years ago. And now I'm a news junkie. I've turned into Alex Skolnick, you know. I know Alex has found it adorable when Stevie D and I are talking about, like, the Raiders or the Cowboys or sports or whatever. And Alex is, you know, he's got his news, and he's probably looking at us like, you two yahoos, you know, why don't you get a little knowledgeable on current events, guys? And, you know, he's never told us anything like that. But now I can understand where, you know, now it's like, fuck, I do not have the focus on sports that I did my entire life, you know, because there's just no time to fit in. You know, I'm gonna read some sports news along with fucking every other bit of news that I'm reading now.
Right.
So.
It's hard. It's you know, I definitely don't know as many people in the cabinet that I should, or the Senate or the House of Representatives, but I could probably tell you 99% of the 53-man roster of the Tennessee Titans. So that's where.
Hey, there you go. Exactly, man. And at least, you know, they're not called the Tuxedos.
Well, there you go. I think, you know, there was. I remember when they were naming the team, and one of the big front runner were the Tennessee Copperheads, and I'm really glad they didn't go with that one.
Oh my God! Yeah. Well, at least it's a snake.
Yeah. But right. No. Oh well. Yeah.
I do remember seeing the interview with a big lineman, and that was a quote from him. He's like, "Well, at least we're not called the Tuxedos." Oh God, I thought that was hilarious. I was a big Tennessee Tuxedo fan growing up. You know, cartoon. You know,
oh,
Don Adams. Yeah, so I was like, "Oh, fuck, a Tennessee Tuxedo reference. That's amazing." But that was 20 years ago, so that's fun.
Well, good stuff. Well, man, it's always great to have you on the show. Oh, speaking of Alex Skolnick, the funny story about Alex Skolnick is when I was interviewing you in person in Nashville at the Slayer show. You know, you and I are talking, and this guy comes in with a hat on, looks disheveled and homeless. And I look at him, and I'm talking to you, and I look over at him again, and I'm talking to you, and I look over one more time, and I'm like, "Holy shit, that's Alex Skolnick!" And you have one of those Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
No, I was just saying, it's like one of those inner fanboy moments, you know, where you're like, "Holy shit, that's Alex Skolnick!" But then, like, you know, and then you got to keep your composure while you're trying to do an interview too.
Oh, that's fun. Yeah, that was probably jogging Alex. If he looked disheveled and homeless, yeah, he puts the baseball cap on. He does his jog. And I know that cap is a little. You know, he's also able to kind of make it through crowds like that, because you know Alex is also he's pretty recognizable musician there.
Yeah, speaking of getting gray in the beard, I'm starting to get an Alex Skolnick gray streak in my hair, which I'm pretty pumped about.
Yeah, fuck yeah, those are awesome.
All right, Gene. Well, I'll let you get on to your Dark Angel stuff. You know, huge thanks once again, and hopefully
absolutely
see you out with either Testament or Dark Angel or your wife, or you know, just out out somewhere.
That sounds excellent, Josh. Thank you very much for the chat, and you know, thanks to everybody for listening. And we'll catch you in a few months, I'm sure, brother.
All right, give me a Dark Angel song to end this off with.
Let me see. Let's go with the super awesome one. Oh, yeah. Here's one I want to hear. A Subtle Induction.
All right, Gene. Take care, and we'll talk to you soon.
All right, Josh. We'll catch you, man. Take care. We'll be right back.
All right, huge thank you to Gene Hoagland of Testament, Dark Angel, and so much more for taking some time, coming on the show, and filling us in on everything in the world of Gene Hoagland. Thank you guys for listening each and every week. And so until next Thursday, I'm Joshua Toomey, and this has been the Talk To Me podcast. Talk to you soon.